This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
You know, when you look at the history of the natural horsemanship movement, one of the things that you discover is that it really began in the Pacific Northwest and California in the United States, and that it was heavily influenced by the vaquero horsemanship that had come before it. Now, everybody, Rick Lamb here for the Horse Show. Vaquero horsemanship, the hackamore system, the California system of bridling, all of them essentially refer to the same thing. We're going to talk about that today and try and understand why it is so important in the history of natural horsemanship. And I also want to direct you to something that's online, another resource that I think will be useful in understanding this. We did a TV piece several years ago. I was very, very happy with how it came out, called The Vaquero. And it's been online for many years and gets lots of activity. People do a lot of talking about the role of the vaquero. But you can find that on YouTube. Just look The Vaquero, Rick Lamb, and you will find it with no problem. One of the people who's kind of knowledgeable about this form of training is Peter Campbell. And so he's our guest today. He's going to talk about the California system of bridling. And that'll be towards the end of our show today. But first, you're going to meet a very flamboyant showman, a fine horseman in his own right. His name is Al Ragusin. I have known Al for years. I seem to run into him a lot at horse expos where he does performances, especially in the evening shows. And he has a thing that he calls kind of dancing with horses. And it reflects kind of a Spanish background as well. So you're going to meet him today. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. We'll be back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Hard work comes with a lot of sweat. That's why there's new Wrangler Cool Vantage jeans. They keep you cool by wicking sweat 5 times faster. They keep you dry by pulling moisture to the outside where it dries faster. They keep you comfortable so you're less restricted all day long. New Wrangler Premium Performance Cool Vantage Jeans. The newest innovation in comfort.
And now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lang.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. We have an interesting guest today on the show. Al Ragusin does some very unusual things with horses. For one thing, he dances with horses, and they dance with him. And as a partnership, they put on a pretty spectacular show. We're going to talk about that today, about his life, some of the interesting things he's done, and his training philosophies for horses. Al, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you, Rick. Glad to be here.
And we were just talking off the air a little bit. You are in the tippy-tip bottommost part of America, right down there at the bottom of Texas. You said about 2 miles from Mexico. But you've also spent some time in Mexico working as a charro, right?
Right, sure did. And also bullfighting off of horses.
Now, for those that don't understand what a charro is, and I'm trying to roll my R a little bit, the charro, that's the equivalent, is it not, of kind of an elite cowboy?
Yes.
What are the principles that go into being a charro?
Well, charro is part tradition, handed down from many, many years, and you have to wear the authentic outfit. You have to use the saddle, the bit. Everything has to be authentic. And they have 7 events in the charreria there. I was the one that did the reining for the team. It's a team sport, and you get points, good points and bad points. If you do some good work, you get good points. If you do some bad work, the good points that someone else might have gotten is taken away. This is more of a traditional thing, like, for instance, of roping. They go through all the twirling the rope, opening the loops, jumping through it, and then rope. So it's more of a theatrical, more of a talent type of performance. We have them here in the United States as well. But, of course, the big ones are in Mexico.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned reining. You did the reining part for your team. Is that similar to the reining sport in America?
Yes. In the years that I did it, it was a lot tighter. For instance, you had to run your horse at full volume, and then you had a 6-foot wide by 20-foot long space in which to slide and stop.
Oh.
You couldn't get out on either side, or you couldn't pass the 20 feet. Now, any time that you go outside the rules, you're disqualified. So, the rest of it doesn't
they,
count.
They don't mess around then, do they?
No. You know,
outside the box, you're out of there, buddy.
Yeah.
Back to Texas.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You mentioned bullfighting, and I know that you do you were doing a kind of bullfighting. A lot of people probably shudder at the thought of bullfighting because they think of it as being bloody and cruel and all that. But you did a different kind of bullfighting.
Right. I did the Portuguese style. This is where nobody gets hurt, and hopefully the rider doesn't either. But what it is that we don't injure the bull in any way. He comes out, and it's more of a theatrical performance. And we use a lot of high school movements, a lot of dressage movements. And what happens is the bull comes rushing at you, and when he lowers his head and takes his eyes off of you, that's the time you got to get out of the way. And if you got a horse that is very well trained and a horse with a lot of nerve, because it takes a special type of a horse to get in the ring,
yeah.
I've never had any problems with a bull coming anywhere close. But what happens is he'll make a turn, and as the bull passes us, we kind of just wait on him and let him just catch up to us, and then we just stay in a circle until he gets tired. And then we'll walk off and prance the horse like saying, all right, you know. And so it's more of a theatrical thing. And then the bull will start to paw, for instance, when he's getting ready to charge. And we'll paw my horse as well. So we're pawing against each other. And when he comes running at me and he ducks his head, I'll jump clear over him with the horse.
No kidding.
And
that's where those airs above the ground, those high school movements come in.
Exactly. That's what it comes in. And then we have another one where we rear him up. The bull sees that, he comes running because he says, now I got him, you know, and then we jump him again. So it's a theatrical thing.
So this is dangerous from the standpoint of not that the bull could, so much that the bull could get hurt, but you or your horse could get gored if you were not quick enough.
Definitely. And so this is something that you don't want to do unless you have the type of horse. Well, I use Andalusian horses for this because they seem to just really enjoy it.
Why do you pick that particular breed for your for not only the bullfighting, but I noticed in your video at one point, I think even written on your trailer, it said your Spanish horses. Why are you interested in Spanish horses?
Well, for a couple of reasons. We have a place called Fiesta, Texas here, and we performed on a stage that is about 6 to 7 foot up off the ground. The stage is only about 20 feet wide and about 30 feet long. It's pitch dark, and we have 3 1,500-watt spotlights. So neither I nor the horse can see the end of the stage.
Wow.
They're not nervous. Once they get that confidence in you, they trust you. And then, of course, they're such high steppers, and their joints are made different. They can, they're a lot flashier, longer manes, short couple. There's just a whole lots of reasons.
Now, and I got to ask you, if you're on that big stage, that high stage there, you can't see the edges. If you make a mistake, is your horse going to catch it, or is he going to do what you said and take you both off the edge of the stage?
He can't. He's also blinded by the light in his face.
But doesn't he have kind of a sense, as you do, to where the boundaries are?
Yes, and what you do is keep very, very close watch of his nostrils.
Tell if he's getting nervous.
If he gets close, he's going to start breathing hard.
Okay. So between the two of you, you hope you've got it pretty well covered. Talk a little bit about the show that you do today and the dancing aspect of what you do with your horses.
Okay, I've been training for over 40 years. I've been riding for a lot longer than that, but actually training over 40 years, and I've gone into all different aspects of training, the reining, the cutting, the pleasure, and all of this type of thing, the charros. And when I kind of semi-retired and I had done everything I thought I could possibly do with a horse, I still felt young enough and strong enough to do something else. And I had trained a horse for a singer in Mexico. And he would do some, like, passage and a little, I call them pefe, I think y'all call them peoffs, mm-hmm. whatever. It's that dancing and, trotting in place.
Yes.
And I did a couple of those. So then what he would do is that he would then play some music that would kind of go with that movement. And that's what dancing horses have always been about. And then I met a guy named Jim Shafraff, at that time was with muscular dystrophy. And he told me, he said, do you think with your experience that you could actually make a horse dance to the rhythm of a song? I told him, I have no idea. I said, I have taken on big projects, but that would have to be the largest. And it takes about 5 years in order to train one.
Really?
And you have to follow the beat of the music. So as I get on the horse, I'm a singer, I'll sing a country western, he'll dance a two-step, I'll do a rumba, and he'll dance a rumba, then I'll dance a rock and roll, and he'll dance a rock and roll. The whole idea is that he stays with the rhythm.
So let me ask you this. Is he actually listening to the music, and does he have a sense of where the beats are and is coordinating that? Or have you just kind of cleverly picked the music so that it kind of matches a good natural cadence for him?
Well, we picked them, yes.
Or both.
We picked the music so it'll be a four-beat rhythm that it's easier for him to pick up.
Yeah.
And then it doesn't really matter. Like, for instance, the passage. Instead of doing a passage, a horse does a passage, he does it at a particular rate, let's say. My passages, I may have three or four passages. So I can use three or four of them. And I'm kind of like the guy with the puppets. You know, I'm pulling a lot of strings all at the same time. So I try to have control of all four legs so I can dance to any rhythm. And a lot of times I have been invited to go somewhere where a band is playing. I have no idea what they're going to play. And I'll tell them, just stay in four-beat rhythms and we'll be okay.
When we return, more from dancing horseman Al Ragusin. We'll learn about the unusual way he uses reins in teaching his horses to dance. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hi, this is Tanya Tucker, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Thank you, Miss Tanya. My guest is Al Ragusin, who dances with horses, and he was just telling us how he does that. Let me ask you a little bit more about the reins. You mentioned a puppet on a string, and it made me think, of course, immediately of the fact that you are using 2 sets of reins. It's not exactly what we traditionally think of as a double bridle, where there's both a curb and a snaffle bit there, nor a pelham. What is it exactly you're doing with those 4 reins?
Well, I didn't invent the 4 reins. I just developed a way of using them. If a horse comes in with a real cold mouth, you can re-educate them with this kind of reins. There's 3 reins. There's one that's rubber, it's elastic, and then you have the 2 solid reins. And you really get into the horse's mind, because when you first put this rein on him, remember, it's kind of like you doing push-ups. If you're going to do push-ups or start doing them, you haven't been doing them, you don't want to do a bunch of them at one time, because you're going to use some muscles that you haven't been used to using. Well, the same thing passes with the double rein. We do this in order to collect him, and then we need to do it slowly. So the elastic rein will give him freedom of his head. It also works as a psychological on him, is that when he's in the ring by himself, and that's the important thing, and I show that in the video as well, leaving by himself with this rein,
now,
and let him figure it out.
Now, let me ask you this, though. The bit that you're using this on is just a standard O-ring snaffle, isn't it?
That's all.
Yeah, so...
In most cases, and then sometimes when I'll have a particular horse that just works better with a little Tom Thumb bit. I have one with a pelham as well, but just a real, real light, because all of the movements and stuff we do, we don't use his mouth at all.
And, of course, what you're getting at is those are leverage style. I mean, the leveraged action of those bits is what you're referring to as, you know,
exactly.
using it lightly rather than the direct action of the snaffle. So you must be a pretty coordinated guy to be able to handle all those reins.
Well, I've done it in such a way that you can handle them with one hand. I used to have a microphone in one hand, and I had to have the reins in the other hand. And so I had to do all these movements with just one hand. You keep refining the cue, and that's what the double rein does. Let's say I have it in my right hand, and I were to twist it to the right. What it does, it pulls the bottom rein and turns the head of the horse into the direction that I want him to go, and then the other rein will push in against his neck. So then as you refine the cue, you can just go to neck reining, because his head will be in a perfect position. But then we're also under extreme conditions when we do a show. We never know what's going to happen. Like, for instance, I was in an arena once, and a little boy had a balloon, and he let it go, and it came right underneath my horse.
Oh, boy.
During a performance. So what the double reins do, it holds him in position. He can move his feet, but he can't move his head.
Yeah.
And it's not that we're roping him in. He's not tied in, because my hand is like the rubber band. If he needs it, I'll let him have it. But it holds him in position and keeps him collected at all times.
Well, I imagine there's another thing, too, there, and that is that from a psychological standpoint, when you're riding with that much contact, I mean, it's like constant reassurance to your horse, hey, I'm here. I've got you covered. I'm taking care of you. Daddy's here. You know, it's that whole comfort level, reassurance.
Exactly.
As opposed to, as a lot of people think when they talk about riding with contact, that it means somehow you got some kind of a straitjacket on this horse's head,
right,
which is preventing him from movement. But it's a psychologically, I think it's kind of a reassuring thing, don't you?
You're exactly right, Rick. That's exactly what they feel. That double rein does all of that, and it's incredible. And in the video, I show people how to measure for their own.
Yeah, I saw that.
I don't sell these. I'm not in it for that. I'm just trying to find the safest possible way that they can learn to ride so that they stay safe and their horses are safe so they can have a great, great life with their horses. I'm not tied to any kind of saddle companies or any kind of bit companies or anything like that. I'm going to try to put you in the safest saddle you can. And if you saw that, then for me, it's the Australian saddle.
Yeah, I did see that.
And it's the safest to learn with the knee pads and the deep and the saddles. And then if you want to, once you learn the balance in your horse and you get confidence and everything, then you can go to English saddles or you can go to Western saddles or whatever the occasion is.
Well, let's back up for just a second and
sure.
And mention a little bit about kind of your general philosophy about training. I thought this was you explained it well, as a matter of fact. You mentioned that that you use what's called negative reinforcement, and I think that on first glance people may take that wrong, but you explained it so well, and it's absolutely right from a behavioral science standpoint. And this is exactly how most horse training is done these days, in that we create a little bit of discomfort for the horse. That's the negative part. And then when the horse responds, gives us a try in the direction that we want him to, we instantly remove that negative stimulus. So it's reward by removal of something negative. So in effect, it's negative reinforcement.
Exactly.
You did not approve, though, of positive reinforcement, which is basically rewarding the horse with some kind of positive reward when he does something. Can you explain a little bit why you didn't go for that?
Okay. First of all, I have come to find out a lot about the horse in these 50 years I've been riding. But one of the things I have found out about him is that he lives in the moment. He lives right now. He doesn't have the ability to think ahead, and he doesn't have the ability to think behind. He can associate things that went wrong, and he will be aware of them. Positive reinforcement is when you give him a treat. So if the horse lives in the moment, you're going to have to give him the treat the moment that he does it. So how are you going to do that if you're on top of him? Right. And my video is about riding and training your horse and training you and your horse at the same time to think together. So if you're doing something in positive reinforcement, then what happens if he doesn't want the treat? Then he doesn't do the movement.
Yeah, you made the point that in your case, where you're a professional and you have contracts to fulfill and you've got to be there to dance with that horse, whether he feels like he wants a treat at that moment or not. So, I mean, that was a very vivid example. My guest again, by the way, is Al Ragusin, and that's R-A-G-U-S-I-N. I trust that I am saying that correctly.
That's correct.
Just like magazine, only with an R.
Exactly.
Only it's spelled a lot different. What's the ethnic derivation of that?
My folks are from Austria.
And his website is dancinghorseshow.com. And this video is called Al Ragusin Horse Training Video, Volume 1, The Basics. Al, what does that sell for?
$34.95. And if they send a $4.95 for shipping and handling. Also want to stress one thing. When I said basic, I didn't mean basic writing. I meant basic my method. And if they want to later on improve their riding and even want to dance a horse, they'll need this basics.
All right. Well, Al, I appreciate you being on the show today. You're an interesting man. You sound like a very nice man. I hope to meet you one of these days.
Oh, I'd love to. And listen, if you ever need a job of training a horse, let me know. I love the way knowledgeable as you are.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Take care.
Thank you, Rick. Bye.
Still to come, it is a way of preparing a horse for the bridle. It goes all the way back to the vaqueros. It's called the California system of bridling. Clinician Peter Campbell is here to talk about it when the horse show continues. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. You know, the state of California is remarkable from a number of standpoints, not the least of which, to those of us interested in horses, is that it produced the California system of bridling. We're going to talk about that today with my guest, clinician Peter Campbell. Peter, welcome to The Horse Show.
Thanks, Rick.
Before we jump into this, just so people kind of learn a little bit more about you, I'm sure they've heard of you. You've been out doing clinics and busy working and spreading the good word for 15-some years. Tell us a little bit about how you got started as a horseman.
Well, kind of the way I got started is when I was real young, Rick, I was around some horses, an outfitter where I was raised when I was young, and that's kind of where I got interested in the horse part. And then from there on, I went and worked on some big ranches in Canada here at the Wine Glass and at the Gang Ranch in D.C. and some other ones down south. Then I moved to California and was riding a lot of young horses and a lot of troubled horses. Then I met a friend of mine, Tom Doran, had an opportunity of a lifetime. I didn't live too far away from him, and he is a master in his own right. He passed away this summer.
Yes.
But I was interested in the horses, and he kind of helped develop it, helped me kind of get developed. And from then on, the horse teaches you as you go, and it just kind of snowballed from there. I worked on some big ranches in California, and really had time to kind of experiment, but to work from where the horse was at, not working from where I was at.
Right, that seems to be a very important theme in the teaching of all of you guys who kind of descended from the teaching of Tom Dorrance, is that our task is really to try and see the world through the horse's eyes and get to where we can work with what's important to him rather than expecting him to work within the context of our human expectations and our human values.
Yeah, that's exactly right, Rick.
Now I'm just curious because Tom Dorrance has become kind of almost a cult figure, which hasn't diminished in the least since his passing.
No.
In the last few years of his life, he wasn't terribly accessible to those of us in the media. Just kind of, I think in some ways it seemed like he was a little didn't quite know what to think about all the popularity of his teaching. What was your feeling about the man and about
his understanding of kind of what he created with this.
Well, I don't think Tom ever headed out to get that kind of notoriety. He is a very humble man, very friendly. I can never remember ever hearing anything bad ever come out of Tom's mouth. Everything was always positive. He just saw all these people were getting interested, and he never really headed for that notoriety. He just as soon not take any credit for anything. And it didn't matter if he helped you for 50 years or he helped you for one day. He didn't want any credit for it. And that's just kind of the way he was. And I think, you know, I never really discussed it that way with him, but it was probably overwhelming. There's been a lot of people kind of come down the pike trying to jump on that bandwagon.
Well, not all of them have had your good fortune to have actually known the man and spent time with him. I mean, he created something, and he certainly didn't do it single-handedly, but I think when you see the phenomenal popularity of what we call, quote-unquote, natural horsemanship, it does trace back to having... started with him in terms of him teaching Ray Hunt, and I know Ray Hunt was one of the people that you first met as well, and that just kind of passing on and the momentum building, and that's kind of how this thing traces back.
Yeah, and you said there the natural horsemanship way, and if we really thought about it, it's unnatural, because if it was natural, everybody would be doing it.
It kind of depends on whose perspective you're coming at that from, whether it's natural or not. It's very unnatural for us. Peter, just as a kind of refresher for people listening, we're going to be talking about a couple of different kinds of bridling systems, or actually three different ways to go, starting with a snaffle bit, which does not invoke any leverage and pressure on a horse's mouth, the hackamore, which doesn't have anything in the horse's mouth at all, but rather uses pressure on the nose and on the pole, and then the final stage, which is the last step in this bridling system we're going to be talking about, is what is called just the bridle, which really implies that it has a curb or a leverage type of bit going with it. Why the three different stages to get to that? Why not just jump to a lot of people do this. Why not just jump to a curb bit?
Well, Rick, if the person understood the feel that went along with it, I believe that you could start a horse in a bridle bit. Now, a bridle bit has various different cheek pieces, and it has various mouthpieces. And I like a half-breed mouthpiece. It's just a little port in there with a little roller. It's not very high. But if you understood the feel, you could start one in that. But you'd have to give the horse some time. And a lot of times, a lot of trouble can come of that. So I think what's easier for the horse and the person is to start them in the snaffle. Of course, you're going to ride them in the halter probably once or twice or three times first. Mm-hmm. Then you're going to ride him in the snaffle bit. And he gets used to something in his mouth, and it's on the corners of his mouth. So then from there, once he's handy in the snaffle, then we go to a hackamore, a 5/8 hackamore with a rawhide core, and it's soft. And I always tell people the hackamore should fit like your hat fits. And I don't know if you ever noticed somebody that had a hat that didn't fit and they took it off and it had a red spot on their forehead.
Sure.
See, that doesn't fit to me. And when you have your hackamore on your horse, it should fit like your hat fit. And you should be able to, if you took a hold of the nose band and pulled it up so the bottom part of the hackamore where the reins were was touching his chin, you should be able to put two fingers underneath there between the nose band of the hackamore in his nose so that he could work his mouth and chew if he needed to.
Peter, why in this system we have something in his mouth and then we take something out of his mouth when we go to the hackamore stage?
Okay.
And then we put something back in his mouth when we get to the bridle stage. Why is that?
Well, the reason we do that is when the hackamore is on there, if you took the right rein and you took the slack out and you pulled on it, it would make contact on the left side of his jaw underneath. It's a different feel. And the snaffle, if you pull on the right rein, it'd draw on the right side of his mouth.
I see.
It's kind of drawing his jawbone over toward you, his nose toward you.
Yeah.
And so if we think about the bridle, when it goes in, really what we want him to work off of is that suggesting rein, which is if you're going to turn left, the outside rein.
Yeah, so it's you're preparing him for neck reining, it sounds like
what
you're saying.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Got it. All right.
And, you know, we go from the snaffle to the hackamore, and then what I like to do is when you ride him in the snaffle and he's good, the next thing you know, you'll put the hackamore on it, and a lot of trouble can come there because the person doesn't give the horse enough time to figure out that different feel, and they get in a hurry, and then the horse, it'll feel like you've never rode him before, although he'll be quiet, you know, hopefully you've done a good job there preparing him, but you'll take him on the right rein, and he'll look left. His jaw kind of gets funny. And you really have to be careful in that area to give him a little time to understand the hackamore. And when he's really good and can do all the maneuvers in the hackamore, then I put him in the two rein, which is a pencil-thin Bozell. It could be 5/16, could be a quarter. And then the bridle. And I just let him pack the bridle in his mouth. I hold the reins, but I don't touch it. And I just let him move around and ride him and do slow work. And if I have to do fast work, I've got the hackamore, the Bozell underneath the bridle, and he understands that, so then I can use that. And once he's good in that, one day you'll take that two-rein Bozell off, and he'll be what we call straight up in the bridle.
Define what that means, straight up in the bridle.
Well, straight up in the bridle means that you no longer have the two-rein setup, which means the Bozell underneath the bridle. And so the only set of reins you have are the bridle reins.
Okay.
And that's straight up is what I call straight up in the bridle.
Gotcha. And the Bozell that you mentioned there that would be used underneath the bridle, is that often called a Bozalita?
It wouldn't be wrong to call it that, but...
It just means a little Bozell, right?
Right, right. But what I call the Bozalita is the Bozell. It's a very small one. And it either has a thong in the middle of the noseband and attaches to his foretop, and or it has a small little hanger, and it just hangs over, you know, like it. You put it over his nose and over his ears, and then the bridle goes on. And then you tie a neck rope around his neck with a bowline.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have the small Bozalita on, that has a hanger on that goes over his ears, you can drop your neck rope through that. And then when you get off, you never lead him with your bridle rein. You leave them on the saddle, and you lead him with that rope. If the Bozalita is attached to his foretop, you don't drop the rope through the Bozell, because if you draw it on it, it would pull it off his foretop.
I see.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. there's a lot to that rig, actually, when you have all of that on there. My guest is clinician Peter Campbell. We're talking about the California system of bridling, and here's my question. Why bother with all of this? I mean, people are doing wonderful things in just snaffle bits these days. I'll ask him when we get back.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD TV.
RFD TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other. how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
You know, we absolutely need your help in spreading the word about The Horse Show. And that's all you have to do. Just tell people you found a show that you think is worthwhile for them to listen to. My guest is clinician Peter Campbell. We're talking about hackamores. Check my understanding of this. When a hackamore is correctly adjusted and the horse is carrying himself properly, it's not really causing any pressure on his nose, isn't it?
No.
Isn't it hanging?
I like it. If you run your hand down your horse's nose, you know, the bridge of his nose, he's got that bone that runs down the center of his nose.
Mm-hmm.
And if you run your fingers down there, all of a sudden it'll get soft, and that's where his nostrils kind of are.
Right.
I like it to hang above that soft tissue, maybe an inch. You know, it depends on the horse. But I don't like it ever, the noseband, to rest on that soft tissue.
Right.
That's very tender.
Do you try and get him, though, to carry himself with his head tucked enough that nose piece is floating? It's not actually making contact?
No, it'll make contact because it fits like your hat fit.
Okay.
There won't be any pressure because you're able to stick two fingers underneath it so that he can work his mouth and open his jaw. If the reins were set up so that it was tight and you couldn't put two fingers underneath there, then it would be putting pressure on there, and then you would be like your hat didn't fit, and he would have a sore spot.
So there may not be daylight showing through it, but it's not creating any kind of pressure to it. It's just contact. It's like riding with contact if you're an English rider.
Yeah.
What is the hardest part when you're teaching this whole transitional system?
You know, I think it's from going from the snaffle to the hackamore.
Mm-hmm.
It's that transition when their horse is doing everything they feel possible correctly, and then they go to the hackamore, and that really seems to be troublesome to them. I don't know why, but they seem like that really is a struggling part. Once they get that part good, then when they put the bridle in, they've got the hackamore, the smaller Bozell underneath there, and so the bridling seems to come a little bit quicker. It might feel foreign to them because they have different kind of reins there,
mm-hmm.
but I think that's more the place where they have trouble.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people today, they're looking at the snaffle bit as a suitable bit for any kind of performance activity with a horse or casual riding, whatever it could be. Why go to all of this trouble to get them straight up in the bridle when the snaffle bit can really accomplish almost anything they want to do?
Well, and that's a good question, Rick. Pride. I don't know the other word for it. You're showing honor to the horse. It's kind of a prestigious thing to him. There's honor involved and there's pride. You're proud. And they like it. They're proud, too. You know, they have feelings. And it's like wearing a blue jeans and a raggedy old shirt to a black tie.
Mm.
You know, you wear the black tie, the suit, and the tuxedo, you just kind of feel proud. And that's mainly, there is no real reason to do that. And in actual fact, in different situations, Rick, I might have my horse in the bridle. If I was going to work a bunch of colts, I might go and use the snaffle because I can get my horse around the other colt and don't have to worry about that bit, maybe him bumping it and jabbing it on the other horse or on the saddle. So a lot of times I'll go back to the snaffle if I got a job or I'm riding in some real thick bush.
Mm-hmm. Is that hard for a horse to do once you've graduated him? I mean, he can go back and forth okay?
No problem.
Yeah.
No problem.
Well,
yeah.
Your technique, of course, is going to be different, and I suspect, let me rephrase the question. I'm sure it's not going to be a problem for you when you're riding a horse because everything about your body language and your hands and all of that would change if you were using a leverage bit versus a snaffle bit. But for an average rider, is it difficult for the horse to adjust to go back and forth?
No, I don't believe so, Rick, because they had all the foundation work done in the snaffle, and it was 100% right as 100% can get, 99 point blah, blah, blah. So no, I don't believe, because you wouldn't ride him any different in the snaffle than you would with the bridle. If he operated with one hand in the bridle, he'll operate with one hand in the snaffle.
Do you do that then when you go back to a snaffle, you just use it one hand?
Well, it would depend on what
If you've taught him the neck rein, of course, he's going to be listening to those cues as well.
Yeah, yeah, you can do that. And you know what I do? Yes, I can do that. But, you know, if you needed two hands, you could use two hands.
Sure.
And that's the thing in the bridle, Rick. In the show ring, you're not allowed to. But if you're out on the ranch riding, there's no shame or no harm if you need to take a hold of both reins with the bridle.
Sure.
And that's a mistake that I see a lot of folks get in a jam. They needed two hands, maybe just to help him tip his nose a little if they're out of the two rein, and they won't. And then what happens is they pull on that outside suggesting rein, and instead of him tipping his nose the way you want him to go, he tips it the other way.
Yeah.
And then a lot of trouble can come of that.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
Back to just for a moment to the hackamore. How do you feel about the fact that hackamores are, they were viewed, I think, for a long time, and correct me if I'm wrong, as a transitional stage, as we've been talking about them.
Right.
But they're kind of getting a new respect, perhaps, as, and again, this goes with pride. People are riding horses for, in hackamores, finished horses.
Yeah, yeah. I think, you know, when I was a kid, what we always heard was, if you didn't know what you were doing, stay away from the hackamore.
Yeah.
And that's all I ever heard. And, you know, there's a lot of horror stories out there, horses that people were riding a hackamore and run off and stuff, but really it wasn't the hackamore that was causing those problems. It was the way it was being used. And so I think now through education and through your program helping get this news out to people, and that's the biggest thing. We need to get this out to the masses. But it's very difficult to get if you phoned up a TV station and wanted to have a little thing on there, it's very difficult to get them interested in it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have so much other things going on in the world. But we need to get it out to the masses so that not just certain people understand it, so that everybody can have a chance to understand.
Well, too, there's this whole tradition that, you know, there's always a chance that would be lost someday if there were not people like you.
I don't think it would disappear totally, but I think there'll be very few people.
Be in the history books.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you think the use of these rope halters with rope reins on them, the quote-unquote rope hackamores, which it isn't a true hackamore, but it has some of the elements of a hackamore. Do you think the fact that people are learning to ride, you know, in enclosed arenas and so forth using that, do you think that is helping them understand conceptually anyway what the true hackamore is all about?
Yeah. Yeah, I do think so. It's really no different. It's just a lot softer. People ride in the halter like that with the reins on it, and they're not afraid to ride in that. But if you took that same halter off and put a hackamore on that horse, and I've seen it 1,000 times, those people would be very nervous about riding him with it because of those myths that this was only for the elite, the people that really understood it. And my feeling is it's no different than the snaffle bit.
Yeah, that's kind of, I suppose if you hear that and believe it, that's going to affect how well you can actually use the thing. You kind of need to go into it with a little bit of confidence.
Exactly.
One last question. I've heard people talk about, well, that horse looks like he could pack a hackamore or whatever. Is every horse a good prospect for this, or are there some that are better than others?
They all get used to it. They can all understand it. You know, some horses have bigger heads. One of the troubles is, Rick, there's not a lot of that good equipment, I mean good equipment, available.
You know, we were talking earlier about Tom Dorrance, and of course those that are familiar with kind of the history of this whole movement know that...
Let me interrupt you 1 minute, Rick. When you mentioned that, something came to mind that his brother Bill told me. When Bill was in the war, he had been talking to Tom, and I didn't mean to cut you off. I apologize.
No, I think we're probably going the same place with this, because I was going to talk about how Bill, as a lot of fine horsemen of that era, would braid his own riatas and do various, and make his own bozals and so forth.
Right, yeah. We're on the same page. I was at Bill's house. There was a hackamore there, and it was unfinished at the bottom. And he says, I was at the war, and I was making this for a horse that Tom had. See, they made them for every horse, just about, if they didn't have one that fit. And he said, but by the time I got back, Tom had already made one.
Yeah, I mean, so guys used to do this. It's a bit of a lost art from that standpoint.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
We're used to being able to just go to the tack store down on the corner and get most of that stuff or order it on the Internet or whatever. So,
right.
My guest, ladies and gentlemen, has been Peter Campbell. Peter's website is willingpartners.com.
Hey, listen, I really enjoyed this, and I have to say I've done a lot of interviews. You are one of the most enjoyable folks that I have visited with, because an interview like this is not easy to do. If the wrong questions are asked, it can be very difficult. And I really appreciate the depth of knowledge that you have and the respect for this way and the research that you did to come up with the right question.
Well, thank you. That's probably the nicest thing anybody's ever said to me.
So, well, I meant it.
Well, thank you so much. My guest again has been Peter Campbell. Peter, thanks again.
Hey, thank you very much, Rick.
Well, this has been a great show, folks, but unfortunately, this hour of the Horse Show is over. Al Ragusin's website, if you'd like to check that out, is dancinghorseshow.com, and Peter Campbell's website is willingpartners.com. Don't forget our website, thehorseshow.com. You can listen to past editions of the Horse Show and catch those Horse Show minutes that are only 60 seconds long. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For the Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.